Hi everyone, welcome back. We're near the end and we saved maybe the best for last. Our next speaker is Bogdan, and he's gonna do an interesting twist that I think you'll wanna listen to, or not. I don't know. But let's see what he tells you. Give him a warm welcome, please.
One, two, okay. I always need to get accustomed to the lag into my voice. This is fine, nothing's wrong. So let me start actually with a personal story. I wanted to speak on this conference, I think, while it was still called Vox Days. It was happening in Colada. It's maybe even a bit before that. So I am a bit emotional that I'm finally doing it, and I'm feeling very happy because of it. And people who listened to me talk before know that I do two things. This actually isn't the title of the presentation. Usually I change the title mid-talk. That's one thing that's different. But I also wanted to try very specific for this one because it is an emotional experience for me. There is going to be a non-small amount of audience participation. So this talk will last anywhere from 28 minutes to like 35 minutes, depending on how much you guys help me. Is that okay? Yeah, okay, cool. So the official title of the presentation is, hey, this looks like a server, Appchains in the future of blockchain scaling. And if it was 2021, this would fill the room. This would be completely fine. I didn't introduce myself. Hello, everyone. My name is Bogdan. I'm one of the co-founders and CTO at Tenderly. And what Tenderly is, it's a full-stack infrastructure platform for Web3 apps and themes. That means fucking nothing to anyone most of the time, but it looks amazing on the landing page. By the way, I curse during this. You're getting my full personality here. But what this actually means, you can think of it like AWS for blockchain, or I don't know, Vercel for blockchain, or something similar. But we're not going to shill Tenderly here at all. Let's start with the concept of participation. This is the easy part, and then on the second half of the talk, you're going to have to help me out a lot. If none of you helps me out, I have an ex-colleague and mentor who I owe a lot, Machor here, who's for some reason taking a photo of me right now, who will do the screaming instead of you guys. So please stand up if you ever deployed something to a blockchain before. Cool. Do you feel alone? Hi. It's the two of us standing, yeah. So please keep standing up. Please keep standing up. So how stand up if you ever sent a transaction on chain. Okay, we have a couple, cool. No throw stuff at them. How many of you know on a very high level how blockchain works? Please stand up. Cool, thank you. Okay, now keep standing up or stand up if you think Web3 is a lost cause. So I have a confession to make. Yeah, you can sit down. No, this is your punishment, your penalty for ever trying anything Web3. No, I have a confession to make. I agree with the last crew. Blockchain makes no fucking sense. The point of this talk, if I succeed, none of you, hopefully almost all of you, don't want to come into the Web3 ecosystem. For us who are already there in the ecosystem, we're here, we're stuck. It's a bit of the Stockholm syndrome. It's a bit of like, we cannot get out. It's very hard. But why don't I want you to get into Web3? Like this future that we're selling to you of everything happening on chain, all transactions, all payment transactions, concert tickets, government voting, like all of these things. Like, yes, the world would exist like that. But the funny thing is, like Visa, which is one of the payment networks, like this isn't doable. This isn't some VP or C-level executive in Visa not wanting to do something. Technologically, blockchain right now is slower than a text file, more or less. Okay, I see some concerned faces. Welcome to the actual title of the presentation, The Incompetence to Scale or the Lies that Web3 Sells to You. I have to start with an excuse. This is an excuse. What do you mean by an excuse? I'm an engineer by trade, so I need to put the constraints into this conversation so when I'm late on the deadline or do something, I have an excuse to make. An example of an excuse is the cap theorem. By the way, all of the images were AI generated. You will see that like it makes no sense what it wrote. It sounds like the words I'm going to say, but the images are very cool, so please stick with me. So this is the cap theorem. Raise of hands who knows what the cap theorem is. Okay, enough that I can talk about this. The cap theorem is a theorem in distributed systems engineering, which says that there's three properties of a distributed system. It can be consistent, it can be available, and it can be partition tolerant. What does it actually mean? A consistent system means that if I write something to a database, for example, and I request the data, that data is there. It didn't magically disappear, it won't magically reappear, etc. Availability means that whenever I send, for example, a request to an HTTP server or any type of system, I will always, 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 always get a response. And partition tolerance means that, let's say we're running our system in the US and in Europe, and for some reason a shark bites off a transatlantic optic cable, the system will still work. So do we understand like these three concepts? And the theorem goes that you can only pick two. So you can either make a system that's consistent and partition tolerant, or a system that's available and partition tolerant. To make this more concrete, a system that's consistent and partition tolerant are banks, for example. If you make a transaction, it will go through, it went through, that's it. If the system, for some reason, isn't working, it just won't accept your credit card in the ATM, for example. This is because they need consistency over availability. If it's an available and partition tolerant system, a very good example is the Amazon cart. So if you ever added something to a cart, added multiple items, and then you go and refresh a couple of times, for a couple of seconds, you're gonna see the cart constantly changing. And this is because the system is available, because Bezos wants to make sure you add everything you want to the cart. It's partition tolerant, it's gonna work no matter how much you hop around the globe, but it's not consistent because it's not important to them. So what is the excuse Web3 has? Introducing the blockchain trilemma. Trilemma sounds more dramatic than theorem. I think that's why we did it. Also, this hasn't been proven, so it's actually an excuse. The previous one was mathematically proven. So a blockchain ecosystem or a decentralized ecosystem can have three properties. It can be secure, it can be scalable, or it can be decentralized. What does it mean for a system to be secure? For a system to be secure, it means that if I send a transaction, that's the thing that happens. So nobody can actually lie that something happened. If I send to Machor here, if I send him a payment transaction, he cannot modify it in any way, shape, or form. I cannot modify it, so it's secure. A scalable system is literally the Visa example I said. How many transactions per second can we process? Visa is doing tens of thousands and hundreds of thousands of transactions per second. I should probably know this as I'm the one preparing this talk, but the Bitcoin network right now does like a few, something like that. So how many transactions can we process? And the third one is decentralized. So a sufficiently decentralized system means that there's enough participants in this system, usually running servers of some sort, running a certain program. And that means that there is more than enough people that no two people can collude, or no three, no four people can collude. So for example, let's say if we have three banks having a blockchain system, we can argue that they can collude and just steal your money. In a fully decentralized system where all of our phones are running blockchain nodes, like, we're not gonna agree with that, so the system is decentralized. So what's the trilemma? If the system is scalable and secure, we lost the decentralization because we can do a lot of transactions, they cannot be changed, etc., but for it to be fast, there cannot be like thousands and thousands and thousands of participants that have to say, yes, this is correct. The next example is decentralized and secure. Ethereum is a good example of this one. So anybody can run a blockchain node, anybody can be a validator, everything's completely secure, but we cannot have the like chief innovation officer from Visa use it for his budget. And then the third one is scalable and decentralized. The thing that we sacrifice here is security. So there can be a thing called the 51% attack, because if you can run a blockchain node on a Raspberry Pi, a company can buy a lot of Raspberry Pis and suddenly be the majority of the network itself. Did this make sense? Cool. I have my excuse. I'm going to reference this when I say I'm talking bullshit. So what I'm going to talk about here now. Web3 is very similar to the Balkans in the sense of we do most things out of spite. And this thing that we're spiteful about is this trilemma or this theory that I just talked about. So coming to the incompetence to scale, in the last 7 or 8 years, there have been numerous tries to get all three in this trilemma. I'm going to talk about three briefly. I was told that this needs to be a technical talk, so you're going to listen to me talk about the technical stuff. So the first one is state channels, the second one is sharding, the third one is sidechains. What are state channels? The idea behind state channels was, if it's very expensive or very slow to do things on chain, a thing that we can do is do most things off-chain in some way. So it means that we're not sending transactions to the particular blockchain network. A good example is a game of chess. Let's say you and I want to play a game of chess. Are you okay with me picking you as, okay, cool. So you and I are playing a game of chess, and then instead of us sending each move on chain, which would be very slow, we would wait for like 15 seconds per move. We would pay like $10 per move, so it would be a very expensive game of chess. The thing that we can do is we can broadcast on chain. He and I are gonna play a game of chess. And then when he makes a move, he signs it with his private key saying, hey, this is a move. And then I sign it as well, say, I accept this as a valid move. And now we both have proof that we agreed that he made the first move. Then I play this next move, we do the same thing. We play back and forth, and the thing is that we have this collection of proofs where up to a certain point we were agreeing how the game was going. So if the game finishes, the person who won can just send the proof on chain, and ta-da, that person won the game. If for some reason I start cheating, he can actually submit on chain all the proofs up until that point, and says, hey, Bogdan wants to do an invalid move here, and I can be penalized for it. So we can play a full game of chess with only two transactions. The problem with this is that this doesn't scale. This is great if there's a couple of counterparties, so 2, 3, 4, 5 participants. But again, all of us in this room would make a system crash. The second one is sharding. And sharding is probably what you think sharding is from databases and similar stuff. So sharding, the idea was, OK, Ethereum doesn't scale, so let's make 1,024 Ethereum. And that will be, yes, and that will be 1,024 times more throughput. The problem with this is that not all things are available on all shards. So if, for example, my account balance is living on shard number 257, and someone else's lives on a shard 540, how are we going to transfer stuff around? So yeah. It ended up this was maybe even dumber. Now, sidechains are an interesting one because it is kind of the only one that's still alive. The idea with the sidechain is you have like a main network, and then you create another network, and then there's a way for you, it's called, to bridge things. So for me to send one thing from one blockchain to another blockchain. Who here knows what Venmo is? Yeah. So the idea behind Venmo is, we go all out to dinner and we want to split the bill and you can Venmo me money. How Venmo works is I send them money from my credit card, and then if I Venmo someone with a Venmo account, they actually don't send the money to the credit card. Everything is inside of that system. But if that person wants to pull money to their credit card, they get like a normal bank transaction. So in that case, we can think of the like banking system in the real world is like a layer one network in a blockchain, and then Venmo being a side chain where all Venmo things are happening. None of this worked. Like, none of this worked. Sidechains are the only one that kind of work. We rebranded them like 6 times, just not to call them sidechains and to always pitch it as a new thing. But none of this worked at all. So let us all dream for a bit. Let's imagine that Nike, I know this sounds like such a change of pace, that Nike has a new sub-brand called Swoosh. What's the idea behind Swoosh? Targeting Gen Zs and people with ADHD since they were born, TikTok, blah, 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 the usual corporate stuff that they want to use their minds. But other than that, the idea behind this brand was to be a digital-first brand. So we can have digital collectibles, I can get sneakers if I have a certain digital collectible, stuff like that. So everything is happening online, but in its truest sense. People can like trade this digital stuff, etc. And then let's imagine there's this small game called Fortnite. And the idea behind our dream that totally didn't happen was for anyone who has a Swoosh account and has a Fortnite account, they can play a very specific level. It's a full-on Nike-branded level. You want to buy sneakers after it, it's so good. But the point of this was, if you play the level through its fruition, you get some sort of award. This one actually is if you also buy the skins and everything. So this is basically some proof that you spent like $25 on a thing that doesn't exist. But thank you for the laugh. Anyway, And then let's imagine you're in the US, you go into the store, your phone vibrates, and it says, hey, because you have the swoosh achievement, 10% off on us, on anything inside the store that you're physically in. On anything. I didn't have the original screenshot, so it said swoosh, not happy birthday. And this is something that I experienced this year. What did happen? So Nike, in some way, we're going to talk about it a bit more and not mention Nike anymore because this is a technical talk, so we need to talk about technical stuff. Nike did a certain way where if you open an account, they make a blockchain wallet for you. I connected to my Epic Games account, like any sort of OAuth or whatever, literally like connecting Google, so it's very Web2, very everything. At that point, Epic Games knows that I have a certain blockchain thing running somewhere. I go to Fortnite, I play the game, get yelled at by a 12-year-old because I suck at it. I play through the level through its fruition, I get the achievement, and suddenly I get the notification saying, hey, on the blockchain you got an NFT. I can go to any block explorer, I can go to the Swoosh app, I can go anywhere. Again, all this data is accessible, you have different front ends, different UIs, and I can see the thing that we saw here. So this was an NFT. Now, the surprise for me was, why I'm mentioning this experience, is that the Nike app, by the way, is an extremely good e-commerce app, like very easy to spend money in it. But the point is, when I entered the store, and of course, because they know how I move, because privacy is dead, basically, I got a push notification saying, hey, we got an offer for you. I open up my inbox, and it says, hey, because you played the level, you can do this. And what's even more awesome is that some other brand can then, for example, see, hey, this person has a Nike swoosh NFT. Let's give them a discount if they come to our brand instead of that. So how is this possible? Something called rollups. Another way to call rollups is the title of the original talk called Appchains, and we're going to see how it's called rollups. There has been three layers of the blockchain being invented. One is layer one, which is Ethereum, Bitcoin, Solana, all the stuff that went up in 2021. Everybody here could buy a house and now basically don't have their savings. So all of those things that you heard about. Then the L2s are the ones around sidechains and other stuff like that. Maybe some of you know terms like Optimism, Arbitrum, etc., Base. The idea behind this is, okay, L1s suck, we can have L2s as a thing which are running fast. How can they be fast? So how can they be secure, scalable, and decentralized? Have we maybe solved the trilemma? So we have app chains. What is the idea behind this? Imagine this thing here is the, for example, Ethereum L1. Above it lives all of the possible multiverses of application ecosystems. So here we have like the Zuckerverse, which for some reason has a lot of metaverse stuff in it. We have the PayPalverse, the Ubisoftverse, the Serbiaverse, like all of these things, like small blockchains existing in isolation. Not really. We're going to cover it. And then the Ubisoftverse, for example, can have an Assassin's Creed app chain on it. It can have a Tom Clancy's app chain on it. It can have a Division. Like, and probably all of those chains would look the same, just like all of their games look the same. Sorry for jabbing if anyone's here from Ubisoft. I think they have great engineering, but are missing some of the creativity in their games recently. Sorry for venting my pet peeves on stage. This is my sort of form of therapy. But anyway, so the idea is we have this underlying L1 blockchains. Anyone can spin an application-specific chain, which can be for a company, for an ecosystem, whatever. Apple can have their own, for example. And then we can spin on top of that, on top of that, on top of that, and recursively do it that way. So the point of this, for this to be possible, is for it to have like general purpose EVM support. The EVM is the Ethereum virtual machine. You can think of like the JVM only even slower, if it's possible. You can have faster transaction throughput, and we're going to see why. And the third one is bundling, which we get the security and the centralization part. It's called bundling or rolling up the transactions. So everything that's happening on an L2, L3, app chain, whichever term sticked with your brain while I was talking, you can take all of those transactions and in some way put them to the secure network, for example, Ethereum. Did this make sense so far? We're going to define it even more. And there's two ways that we can do a rollup. One is an optimistic rollup, and one is a ZK rollup. And the difference between them is, this is going to start making more and more sense, trust me. One uses something called fraud proofs, the other one does something called validity proofs. So what does this all mumbo jumbo actually mean? It means you should buy Ethereum. No, I'm joking. Sorry. So the first one is for optimistic rollups is for you to have optimistic verification. What does this mean? We have a network that's doing thousands and thousands and thousands of transactions per second. And then what it does is once every 7 days, it takes, not really, I'm lying to parts of you, parts of this for you, but takes all of these transactions and sends them to the L1 chain. Why is it called optimistic? Because it's trusting none of the people are colluding and doing something wrong. And there's incentive mechanisms making sure that nobody's screwing around with the data and everything else. So we optimistically were executing all of these transactions. Imagine like a very, 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 very long database query that we commit every 7 days. The incentives and penalties, as mentioned, are there to penalize anyone not participating in the ecosystem correctly or give rewards to people who do. And then the third, which is a problem with them, is that they are correct every 7 days. So if I'm doing some transactions on optimism, which is one sort of these networks, if I want to put money to Ethereum, I need to wait 7 days for this optimistic rollup to be confirmed. How do I dispute if something's wrong? I basically say, hey, this transaction is wrong. And then on the Ethereum blockchain, so if this is the L1 and Ethereum is if this is the L2 and Ethereum is the L1, I execute the program, one instruction by another, and I prove that it's correct or it's incorrect. So imagine your Java program not doing something, and you're going through the bytecode until you actually find the place where it's wrong. Only in this case, it reverts what happened completely. So how do ZK rollups work? They have instant finality. What does this mean is we don't need to wait 7 days. How does it work? I have no fucking idea. Why? Because I suck at math. Now, there is some sort of linear algebra and other stuff, which I'm quite sure some of the people in this room would understand. I'm not going to fool you that I do. But the whole point is that you can mathematically verify that a certain thing is correct given the inputs and the outputs without actually executing a function. What does this mean? It means that you can prove that if you're doing, for example, addition, and your inputs are 2 and 3, and the result is 5, you can prove that 5 equals 2 plus 3 without actually doing the addition itself. It sounds straightforward, but it's very complex for some other stuff. How could you prove, for example, if you send an API request, that it has been correct? In this way, you can actually prove these complex things, complex programs, in a very efficient way that something was true or not. There's no dispute delays because, again, once we submit the proof, that's it. It can be instant. But the problem with them is that they're technologically very complex. So right now, there isn't a Turing-complete zero-knowledge virtual machine that can prove everything that it's doing. You can make a non-Turing-complete one, because then not everything in existence can exist, and then you can actually mathematically prove the stuff that it's doing, that it's valid or not. The thing is that these problems, all of this stuff that I talked about, are extremely challenging to work on. Like, very challenging. The mathematical stuff, so all of the research that needs to go into it, all of the engineering work, all of the systems design work, like, all of these things are very complex to build. And then building on top of those systems can be even more complex. But I think as an engineer, these things are very fun. So we're coming to the interactive part of the presentation. This will either be the coolest thing that you saw today or the worst thing that you saw today. And I'm going to need your help for it to make it cool. So for the non-Serbian speaking folk, this is a screenshot from the Serbian subreddit called Ar Programiranje, which is subreddit R Programming, where someone asks, how does the interview process at Tenderly look, the engineering interview? And it says, as for the interview, there's two parts. The first part is something that already happened. In the case that my friend got, it was how to follow a blockchain fork. But the second part of the question is usually something they pull out of their ass. They don't even know the answer to it. So yeah, let's do a systems interview together. I'm going to shout things, and you're going to shout answers to me. Is that fine with you guys? Yes. OK. I have a backup plan where I split my personality in two, but I didn't practice it nearly enough for it to be that good. So we're building a blockchain node. What does a blockchain node do? It does these things. Very briefly, transaction submission, imagine writing to a database. Blockchain query means searching across the data that we stored. You can pull out your notebooks. It gives block information. So for each array of transactions, for example, we have some information like the timestamp when they were submitted and stuff like that. It does network interaction. We don't care about that much. Smart contract interaction, this means invoking user programs. So imagine booting up a VM, a virtual machine, doing a program and shutting it out. Event listening, it means what it means. So an event is emitted and you need to notify something, an event is done. And it does blockchain synchronization because this is a decentralized system. How do we send information to each other? So let's focus on the read part of the problem, which is the white stuff that's left. So blockchain queries, block information, smart contract interactions, and event listening. Which database would you use?
Excel.
I do think most of the world, by the way, runs on it. But come on. It's a lot of data.
Cassandra.
OK. Any other suggestions? Postgres, okay. MongoDB, okay. By the way, you're in a crowd. I'm on the stage. Do shout. Like, I cannot even see half of you. So we have Mongo, Cassandra, and Postgres. Cool. So the amount of data is around 150 terabytes. Are you still staying with your picks? We have some colluding. So are we sure about Cassandra, Mongo? Does Mongo work in this case? Probably not. OK, sure. Do we have any other ideas? So I think we're still sticking maybe with Cassandra, correct? OK. Elasticsearch, anyone? No? What?
Files.
Actually, you are very, very close. Influx. OK. So how do we store the data? If it's Influx, it's a time series database, correct? If it's Cassandra, we do the like column store thing, where we need to make sure that the columns don't change, because migrating a 150 terabyte table is very hard. But the problem is that we only have access to the inputs and the outputs of the programs. So imagine having a SQL query of all of the inserts, but you only know, you don't have the actual data that's inserted. You only have like the parameters of the query and if the query was successful or not. So are we still using Influx? Are we still staying with Cassandra? GraphQL? OK. OK, let's move on. So how do we query the data? So with Influx, we're doing time series queries. It is a very good way. The problem arises. Oh, actually, I'm skipping ahead of it. I think that's a straightforward one. Influx solves this for us. For Cassandra, how would we do it? We have to do like the ranged queries, correct? Yeah. Sorry. Can you still hear? Yeah, you can still hear me. The problem is that most of these responses have to be sub 100 milliseconds. So are we still sure with the picks? Cassandra needs to wait for everyone to accept, like the majority of the cluster to accept the read for it to be valid. For Influx, I think we're still there, but Influx falls somewhere else. What if we want to query the data that is part of the execution? So imagine if you were debugging a program in JetBrains, Visual Studio Code, or whatever, and you want to query the variable mid-program, like what's the value of variable A? So Influx kind of falls there because suddenly we don't have the time series data. Cassandra would actually be good here for some sort of thing. I know it's getting more and more depressing. The problem is that if we want to store all of these things, the data would be in petabytes in size, maybe even more. I actually didn't do this calculation correctly. There's additional stuff that we need to do. So it has to have multiple regions across the globe because the blockchain is decentralized. There's no backends usually. So the users can be in the US, in Europe, Africa, Asia, like anywhere. So this has to work everywhere. It has to have read consistency guarantees because imagine if you open up your bank account and your money is not there. You close the application, open up the application. The money is there, but then it disappears. Did they lose my money? What happened? Like it has to be like this is financial data, like billions and billions of dollars. It has to be read consistent. There is something called reorganization support, which is imagine for 10 minutes you're collecting all of the data and suddenly you get the notification, that didn't happen. Like these 10 minutes were a complete lie. Here are the actual 10 minutes that happened. Suddenly the writes and updates are getting more complex. And the thing is that re-executing with different inputs is also important. How can I know? Like let's, for example, change the currency exchange ratio between the Serbian dinar and euro. Let's now simulate for the past week what would have happened in the economy. Like all of these things are very important, very hard to solve. And then one, which was part of the interview question that was mentioned on Reddit, is how can we, for this 150 terabytes of data, for each user create copy and write replicas sub-second spin up thousands and thousands and thousands and thousands and thousands of disk replicas each hour without giving like millions to Google and AWS. Isn't it extremely fun? This feels like crosswords, but like you're kind of drunk and have a broken leg, and it's extremely hard. But I find this interesting. And the thing is, it's going to get even more fun or harder, depending on how you perceive engineering issues. But the thing is that right now we have, of the EVM chains, for example, Ethereum, Polygon, Arbitrum, Optimism, Avalanche. You don't have to count, remember the words. It's just the numbers that are important. Base, let's say 9 or 10 of them. Remember Appchains? Nike can spin up their own. Remember Ubisoft? They can spin up one for Ubisoft and then one for Assassin's Creed, one for Tom Clancy, et cetera. So we're going to be having hundreds and thousands of these chains being spun up, being spun down. Let's say, for example, we want to play the game of chess. Do we want to spin a blockchain just for that particular game of chess and then just delete it? And this becomes much, 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 much more complex. And then a brief segue into Google and AI and LLMs, because it's 2023 and I have to talk about this, I was told. So why Google? I think it showcases that it's a tough engineering problem where there's a lot of value. It was interesting that Google is, for example, trying to poach some of Tendrily's users, but they are sticking with us because we're so far ahead, because we have been doing this for 5 years and they just started. But it is a very interesting form of validation. And then why AIs and LLMs? In the beginning of 2000s, like most of these things existed, by the way, that like ChatGPT, not really, couldn't have existed, but like the building blocks were there. And most of the scientific community that was telling us that that was the future was kind of cast off as outsiders because like you guys have no idea. And then somebody had an idea to put it on a graphics card and blah, blah, blah. And 23 years later, everybody's here using ChatGPT to write emails and Jira tickets. But the thing is that with blockchain, kind of the same thing is happening. And my final statement with that is today is if you understand satire, or if you understood satire in this talk and the sarcasm, if you really, really, really want to solve some problems unsuccessfully for years, fail for years and years and years in solving these engineering problems, and this was just one of them that we went through on our systems design interview, until one day we actually fucking solve it, there's a place for you in Web3 and Tendrily. And thank you so much. Questions? What? Yeah, does anybody have questions about anything? I can share the prompts for the images afterwards if that was going to be one of them. I think there's a question there. Literally on the opposite side of the room from you. I can repeat it if you want to. What was the answer to the interview question that we did here? So interesting fact that we say to most people when they come to an interview at Tendrily is that you have an hour to solve something that we are trying to solve for 5 years. It's impossible. The whole point is to hear you think. So all of these were correct. If we were there for an hour, we would probably talk about more stuff. If you joined the company, you could actually see some of the code tackling these issues. But yeah, so unfortunate answer. I guess pulling it out of our ass part of the Reddit comment is probably correct, but yeah. Any other questions? Cool, I think that's it. Thank you so much, everyone.